Good afternoon, everyone. Having a good time so far? Louder. Louder. Very good. Great. So in continuation with the theme that we had for the last panel, which was to discuss on the IaaS, PaaS, SaaS, and security scenarios around it, we have this interesting panel on touching a very, very relevant and contemporary topic in the larger scheme of things around digital transformation. And we heard, for some of you who were there yesterday and today in the main sessions, a lot of talk around how digital is becoming all pervasive and digital is becoming the new way of doing business, if you will, in almost every vertical that we can think about, right? And as we think of digital, naturally enough, IoT and internet kind of becomes extremely important areas or subjects where companies are investing a lot of time, energy, and effort on, right? And we heard yesterday on an interesting keynote from Ericsson as to how in the next 5 years about 50 billion connected devices will exist in the world, right? So it's literally 6 to 7 devices per person. Assuming there will be 8 or 9 billion in the next few years, it's roughly about 6 to 7 to 8 devices per person, right? So we'll be living in an ever connected world, and which is where I think while the growth is happening, there are rising concerns around the security of being connected, right? These connections could be between people, between processes, things of course you're all aware of, that's why it's called Internet of Things. But through Internet of Things, you're actually connecting people, processes as well, right? And as these connections happen, the threat around security is becoming all the more real. At least that's the point of view we have. And we want to learn from the panelists today, and we have a fairly diversified set of people here coming in from very, very different backgrounds to sort of talk to us about the reality of IoT and the security threats around it. We've all, as someone was saying in the last panel, at some point we've all been hacked, right? At some point we do share critical information about us, about our companies, about the places that we visit, either intentionally against an incentive or unknowingly, right? We're sharing a lot of this information, and which is where a lot of those breaches are happening, and we'll talk about some of the examples. So I just want to get straight in and maybe go across the table to really sort of help the audience understand what is this noise about IoT security that we keep hearing, right? Is that even a real threat to consider as enterprises are thinking of digital transformation? So maybe Arvind, we'll start from you, and then we'll go across and understand what's really happening, what's the reality around this.
Yeah, thanks. So the issue is IT, IoT, what is the difference? So the thing I would like to say is that IoT is a safety issue. If an IoT device is hijacked, it can cause death, life and death issue. The Ukraine stuck next to your heater is hijacked, thermostat is disabled, it can blow up. So when we are talking of IoT, it's not so much security as a safety issue, and the loss is not of some dollar or money or reputation, it is life. So it is a lot more serious. So the normal reasons why an attack happens are financial. They may not be large in many IoT cases because the data, privacy is not of great value to the criminal. It's of great value to the enterprise using it. GE can do a lot more with the turbine data, but a criminal will not be able to do much. The risk is much more of malicious actors who want to cause harm. And in that case, it's very, very serious.
Right. Krishnan, your point of view?
Sure. So how many of you took probably a public transport in terms of reaching here? Show of hands. I took the metro and it was really great. So just wanted to share on that. See, reason why I started with public transport is, let me share with you some statistics. Across the world, 1.3 million accidents, 1.3 million people lose lives every day. Every year, sorry. Not a good scale to be in. India actually is closer to the top of that table. 12 to 15% of those 1.3 million happens in India. Just to give you the statistics, every minute there is a major accident that is happening on the road. But we all still came out here. Why? The reason why I wanted to actually put the statistics and actually put it across was, is it something to be serious about, something to be concerned about? Absolutely, yes. Is it something to be worried about and getting scared about? Heaven no. There are many things, and we'll cover it actually later as a part of the panel. There are many things which you can do where you can go ahead and look at it in terms of actually much more easier way. Uber is unfortunately poor folks are actually the punching bags now. So let me give you an example. In 2014, we had the very, very unfortunate incident in Delhi about actually the lady in the Uber cab getting this. But today in 2017, when we are thinking about it, probably actually inside Uber, the company, it was more dangerous than actually on the road. So it's all a perspective, and you need to think about it in terms of actually how to go ahead and think about the security. Is it something to be of concern? Yes. But is it something to be scared about? Definitely no.
So we'll touch upon that a little more. But concern versus worried, you being from an enterprise which has been there for a fairly long period of time, in the midst of transformation, where your customers are transforming and you are also transforming, what's your take on IoT security? You're in many ways becoming IoTized, right? So.
Yeah, I mean, there's a fundamental shift in the kind of company that I represent. It's happening. We heard also in the morning a few of the companies there actively saying that they want their electronic products today, which are kind of, they're not connected. They would like to make it IoT enabled or IP enabled. And that's the direction most of the organization in this space are going. So I want to touch upon two aspects, why it's important. Traditionally, we need to understand the difference between an enterprise IT and an IoT IT, because in case of an enterprise IT, you have a defined perimeter and you are able to control quite a few things within that perimeter. The moment you talk about an IoT IT or IoT system, you actually are always talking in terms of an ecosystem. What that really means is you are going beyond your enterprise, you are talking to or you're liaising with different entities beyond your organization. And you need to make sure that when you are actually building a complete IoT stack, the partners whom you take along have the similar security values that you want to carry as an organization. And that's very, very important. The second aspect of it, what Arvind was trying to touch upon, I want to give another example of safety and security. There was a much publicized incident about one of the autonomous car crashing onto a truck in the bylane because it was not able to differentiate the contrast between the container and the brightness of the sky. And it was completely non-malicious, and that's a safety issue. But if you look at it from another perspective, the same thing can be used to actually crash the cars. So these are important issues, and we need to really look at it. Probably when we continue the conversation, I would like to touch a bit more upon how to take care of it in a complete IoT stack solution.
So let's come back to that. But I think you made an important point about IoT being not really done internally, but leveraging the ecosystem around you, the partners around you. And you at Persistent are one of those cool partners that you've been working with for your customers and in different scenarios of being software-led, and IoT is a big focus area for Persistent as well. What is your take? What are your customers coming to you for, and how are you addressing the security challenges in IoT?
Sure. So one of the problems going last in an esteemed panel is they make all the good points. So I think the fundamentally we work with two different types of companies. One is the product companies, where these are the companies making the IoT products. And if you see that, you know, despite even in traditional software development, the OWASP top 10 vulnerability list has not changed much over the years. We seem to be still making the same security mistakes in traditional software development. On an IoT scenario, it's even harder because you're working with constrained devices. So the same stuff like how to run a secure service, how to manage your keys becomes worse. So what we emphasize there is more of, you know, the best practices around how to develop securely for constrained devices. On the flip side, on the enterprise space, these are the consumers of these IT. And when you're designing an enterprise solution that uses IT, he said, the boundaries are blurred, right? And you have to design a solution with trust zones, model your threats accordingly. So there the conversation shifts differently. How do I incorporate IT in my business process and still keep my enterprise safe? How do I not let the security camera be the conduit to steal my, you know, 10 million customer database? So that's a whole different perspective than securing products.
Very interesting. And I think one of the things that we keep hearing in the larger context of digital is in terms of the ownership, right? If I'm an enterprise in industrial manufacturing, or if I'm an enterprise in retail, or in a banking scenario, by the way, banking has a lot of IoT use cases, and insurance has a lot of IoT use cases, right? Who owns IoT initiatives, right? And by virtue of that question, invariably, who owns security of IoT solutions kind of comes into perspective, right? So again, I want to go across, and Arvind, you have looked at the ecosystem more from an outside-in perspective. What is your take? I mean, to land the effectiveness of IoT and security and ensuring that you are able to get the right outcomes, how important is the ownership and who does the best job there?
Actually, I will say that you have framed the question wrongly.
Okay.
See, there are various things you can do as an individual, making sure you don't have default passwords in the devices you have. But that's like your Bluetooth device. How many of you set a PIN which is difficult to remember?
Exactly.
Very few. Then you can ask the manufacturer to do. But fundamentally, and this is something which is a slightly controversial, but at the IoT forum and the CISO platform, we have a task force for IoT security. Our conclusion is that is a wrongly framed question. IoT security cannot, and I repeat, it doesn't matter if you spend $1 million and build a Fort Knox device, cannot be done by the individual enterprise. It's a state, it's an ecosystem thing. The government has a role. Delegated network operators have a role. Criminal behavior has to be stopped before the criminals enter my enterprise and cause me harm. If 10 guys are rioting and come in my house, it's too late to stop them. It's the job of someone else, distributed denial of service, the American approach, which is to wait till evidence of harm is clear before the operators, is wrong. So we are asking for a Class E network for IoT. Prevention is far better than cure when safety is involved. So we are saying that IoT security cannot be done solely by the individual enterprise. Cannot be done solely by the individual owner. The cyber networks need to have a cyber CCTV. There needs to be preventive section 144 for theft attack.
No, but who owns it?
That is the state, the police. It's a nation's, we are talking of criminal behavior. In cyberspace, there's a lot of confusion. Let's forget it. I don't want anybody from Belarusia connecting to my thermostat. I want criminal behavior, which is currently governed by national laws, to be amenable to cyber patrolling.
No, so Krishnan, I think from your perspective, because you've been dealing with customers who've invested a lot of money in IoT, right? What are the common pitfalls you are seeing, which is where the gap exists, and which is why probably you and companies like yours step in and sort of advise them and ensure that they do things in the right way. What are the common pitfalls you see? And then I would love to hear a comment again on the ownership bit in the customers that you are dealing with. How are you seeing the ownership patterns of IoT and security to come along?
Definitely. So what Arvind touched upon, if you look at it on the security food chain, what Arvind touched upon is actually what is there at the head.
Right.
Which is probably the state taking responsibility in going ahead and doing, setting everything right, especially the criminal aspects, because it is not on the simple privacy aspects actually that we are bothered about.
And I just
about.
Want one comment. Is it all about criminal aspects? Or there are in general, yeah.
There is something to do individually.
Sure.
Yeah, so this is one end of it. Now let me, how many of you folks actually from enterprise businesses actually out here? Yeah. So for each one of you, and this is a question actually which comes as a continuous refrain to me, is whenever I speak to an enterprise, they, before thinking about actually how I can leverage and how I can gain benefit from IoT, people are worried about actually IoT security.
Interesting.
So I look at it more from the tail end. So Arvind was looking at it in terms of policy, standards, patrolling, all of that actually from one end. I look at it from the tail end. As an enterprise customer like you, who wants to step in and actually do something in IoT, is there something that you can do? So probably 10 years back, how many of you experimented? I'm not asking now. How many of you experimented with e-commerce? I'm sure most of you would have done. Did you go in and actually do a 1 lakh laptop purchase day one from an e-commerce vendor? If you did, then there is something probably wrong with you in terms of how you experimented. So you will make those simple purchases, you will make those actually simple attempts initially, and then look at it in terms of moving forward into higher mature use cases. I'll give you a live example. I'll give you actually a real life use case, which my company is actually implementing. Our solution is getting implemented in the world's largest adhesive manufacturing plant. This is called the Henkel Dragon plant. You guys want more details on it, you just go ahead and search for Flutura and Forbes. You will get those details actually on the Forbes article. But when we started conceptualizing this use case, there were various possibilities that are there. Like for example, there is actually machine data that is coming in. How do you make use of those machine data to understand in real time whether the glue that I am actually manufacturing is going to be of good quality or not? Second, it could be used to say, last 200 batches or 2,000 batches that I manufactured, what were the correlations, what were the critical aspects that I need to take care of when we need to go ahead and do it? So the first one is actually what we call as the pulse. In real time, you're getting to know in terms of whether something is going wrong or not. Second one is actually what I'm calling as actually the quality forensics or quality correlator, as we call it. The third one was quality prediction, where at the time of loading the machine, we were trying to predict saying that, yes, the quality of the batch, depending on the raw materials and everything, and based on the machine operations, whether it is actually going to be proper or not. All three of them are different levels of maturity as far as the solution is concerned. And the last level of maturity, which we have not even gone to, is based on all of this insights that is actually done in real time, control the machines to manufacture at the right live quality. It was a decision that was taken globally saying that the finger on the trigger, the final action that gets done, is going to be by a quality person. Now here is a case, a $300 million problem is what actually we are solving. Solution already live at actually 70 lines across the globe, getting scaled to 1,200 manufacturing lines across the globe. In all of this, where is the threat? It is actually housed inside the firewall. Initially we started in Azure, we pushed it inside. Everything is under control. Everything is actually within the boundaries of this, but there is business value to be derived. For all of the enterprise folks who are sitting in this audience, my advice would be, pick the use cases properly. Wet your feet before actually jumping in. So identify those use cases which are less trend sensitive and go ahead. There is enough and more value to be unlocked in IoT.
So the other, I think that's a great point. The other school of thought is, given the way digital is evolving, and we were talking about examples yesterday, how the manufacturing of cars have come down from 50 months to 26 months, right? So it's kind of reduced by 50%, and because the needs of the markets are evolving, right? And in which sense, the point I'm trying to make is, enterprises want to be experimenting a lot more faster. The time, there's paucity of time, right? They don't have enough time to be able to do things ahead of what customers want, and which is why a lot of time they are not very clear about the outcomes in the first place on the use cases, right? They try, they invest, they fail, right? And it's the whole agile way or startup way of looking at things, and which is why, in my view, they might have been missing on the security related issues and vulnerabilities around it, but they don't want to get stopped on the experimentation part or the speed of execution part. Is that counterintuitive in many ways or?
Not really. Here is again actually for enterprises. Unfortunately, I am an industrial guy, I'm a grease guy. So sorry, my examples will be more towards enterprises and that too manufacturing led on. Let me give you another example. We find a lot of customers who are not from the IT department coming in and wanting to start projects. And the easiest way, the last thing, I don't know how many IT folks are there, but the last one that any organization, any business side of the organization want to do is actually get embroiled with IT. Because that getting that one hardware setup itself can actually take 6 months, while the entire speed with which you need to innovate, actually 6 weeks, you can go ahead and go live with the application itself. In such cases, there is a tendency for people to go outside the standard boundaries of basic health checks,
right,
to be able to go ahead and actually continuously accelerate, continuously go ahead and experiment. You need to be a little careful on that. There are ways and means in which actually that also gets done, but you need to be a little careful about that, because if suddenly actually a manufacturer is the most critical machine of his, he is suddenly going ahead and passing on all the information in real time to an external cloud, unknown vendor, going ahead and doing things. There could be risks that are introduced. But in my mind, I will still say it is better to wet your feet, identify the right use cases. There are enough and more. I can actually, see, you were talking about actually cars getting manufactured in 50% of the time. Oil and gas is actually close to us. To drill a well, drill an oil well, it used to be something close to around 3 months, bare minimum, even 5 years back. Today, it gets done in 12 days. That's the power. It's five times the speed
Seduced.
At which actually it has gone in. So things are improving. Use case you pick, that's all.
So on the use case part, Bosch, right? Very interesting dimension. You are operating from a legacy perspective. You've been dealing with automotive industry, which is going through massive transformation, right from what Tesla is trying to do to how Uber and sharing economy platforms are coming in. So there are sets of opportunities around IoT that you have in that ecosystem. And you as a company itself is transforming into new lines of businesses, right? New sets of products that you're taking to market, which are instrumentable, right? Where you can instrument them, make them intelligent, and derive value for yourself and for your customers. How does this bi-model way of looking at things, protecting existing core and moving to newer things, and bringing IoT as a perspective together and ensuring everything works fine, how does that happen at an organization like Bosch?
Okay, maybe I'll start off with some comments which were made before. Yes, governance and the assurance behind that governance is important. But I like to take another point of view here is as an owner of a product, you also have equal stake in bringing up the security. Let me take an example. If a car crashes by breaking a traffic signal and crashes onto your car, yes, the other person has made a mistake, but it's also your responsibility as a car manufacturer to make sure that the airbags function and also that the anti-lock braking system also functions. So there is some amount of responsibility which we cannot do away with, and it's important. Now coming to the question that you are asking about the shift in of course, the entire automotive industry is undergoing rapid change at this point. I mean, it's a point of flux, and the whole way of mobility itself is fundamentally shifting from running based on a fuel engine to a computer-operated machine, if you may call it. So obviously that brings up a different dimension here, and that's why I was alluding to this topic of complete stack of IoT. And if you want to, as Bosch, I want to provide services in that space, I have to go back to the basics, what it means. I need to have clear, I would say, guidelines for prevention, for detection, and response. These things have to be as part of design and not an afterthought. When I say prevention, it's not just about preventing what has happened, but you need to prevent it right from the time you're designing the system, from the time you are thinking about how do I code it, and also running your pen test. Coming to detection, you need to plan for your intrusive detection systems. You need to plan it right at the beginning. You can't plan it as a bolt-on in the end because there is very high likelihood that you will miss out of something.
Right.
Then we are talking about the response. Yes, you may have a preventive mechanism, you may be able to detect it, but how quickly you are able to isolate it and you are able to take action against it, these are important aspects. And as an organization which wants to go in that direction of providing a complete stack IoT solution, you need to take care of all these things.
So prevention, detection, and response, right? So Pandurang, with that theme, we'll come to you and you know, understand from you, in terms of your recommendations to customers, right, as you advise them and sort of help them in that journey, what are the three or four things that you are recommending to them to ensure that their IoT system works and deliver the right set of values while being very secure and robust at the same time? So what should be the takeaway for the enterprise audience that we have here in terms of thinking about their first step to IoT?
So again, there are two sets, like I started off with, right? The enterprise customers, I agree with what Raghuram said, that, you know, the kind of steps, multi-tiered approach that he talked about, mm-hmm. you have to understand that these are like your regular enterprise devices. And towards the example you gave about, you know, all the manufacturing equipment being inside your firewall. So while I agree with that, that's also a classic trap that sometimes people go into, that since they all operate inside, I mean, there is not as much of a attack surface as the rest. But the problem is, they might all be safe inside, but if there is another entry point, the attacker, as they do their reconnaissance, they find the weakest point inside. And while they're already in, now your IoT devices become the number one softest target.
Right.
So the point is, you know, treating these not as a minor devices or an afterthought, but to treat them same as you would, the way they make us do password resets every 30 days. I don't want to get into that, but you can't install anything on my laptop without jumping through three hoops.
That's
but cool. An IoT device, which is much more vulnerable, doesn't get the same level of scrutiny. So I think that is number one. The other point I would also address, I think we are both disagreeing with Mr. Arvind here, on the responsibility, right? So I think while he is not wrong, the point is the target is painted starkly on IoT devices today.
Right.
Kaspersky report that was recently published said they had about 3,500 malware samples last entire year, specifically targeting IoT. And in January through May of 2017, or April of 2017, in just those 4 months, they have seen more than twice.
Wow.
Nearly 7,200 samples of malware specifically targeting IoT devices. So I'm the doom and gloom guy. Winter is coming, folks. So all the enterprise.
We'll come
folks.
To you, Arvind. We'll come to you in a moment. So why didn't you complete your point of view?
Yeah. So I think the in terms of developing, deploying these devices in the enterprise, they are an extension of your enterprise. So you must do threat modeling just the way you would deploy a new you know, IT infrastructure. You have to create zones. You have to create you know, trust zones. You have to create your risk models. And risk, it goes, there I agree with a little bit with him, which is, you know, risk is your probability of the attack and impact.
So let me add one point to this, and then I'll come to you, Arvind. We were, as consulting company, we were advising one of the enterprises on their IoT strategy, and when we looked at one of the verticals in industrial manufacturing, we were evaluating some of the use cases, and it turned out that for a single use case to be effectively landed, you need to involve about 27 to 28 different partners in the hardware layer, in the application platform layer, in the edge computing layer, in the analytics layer, in the big data layer. If you look at the entire ecosystem of IoT, you need to involve about 27, 28 different partners because you don't have all the capabilities in-house. And the big question then becomes as to when the issue of security comes in, who should be held accountable? There are these 27 people who have provided a certain scenario, a sensor or a tag or a platform or an analytics solution and things like those, and they stay with an enterprise for a moment and then they come out because their job is done and it's the enterprise who's running it, right? So who takes the onus? Who has the responsibility when we look at the stack view of adoption and many people coming together, right? Because not many of them will stay put in the use case development at some point, right? So how do you decide accountability?
I think that's where, in a simple way, that's where the deployment partner or the deployment agency has to take ownership, and which is why you can't avoid IT, because at the end of the day, the buck stops with them. So I think while I agree with the sentiment about IT being a speed breaker on some of the business initiatives, but at the end of the day, everyone else has left. They are the ones taking care of all the devices. They are the ones integrating into the cloud. The other approach is what Bosch is. We joked earlier about the end-to-end game, and that's the other approach where they are coming in and saying, "You partner with us, and we'll take care of it end to end."
So we'll quickly go to Arvind, seek his comments, then come to you for your inputs.
Yeah. Okay. Now, most of you are enterprise providers. There's a whole lot of brainwashed thought process we have. So let me illustrate how brainwashed we are. But before I go there, there's a lot of technical stuff you can do, and we have an advisory. So we're very deep technical. 80% of IoT attacks can be avoided if your IoT device cannot be addressed, does not have a static IP. It wakes up, it calls mother, sends message, and shuts down. This simple architectural approach will remove a lot of problems, but those are okay. Let me take an example to illustrate how brainwashed we are thinking about IoT security as an individual's job. Let's say I go to the city of San Francisco, I buy a plot, I ask an architect to build a house, he gives me a house, and I go to Starbucks, have coffee, come back, my house is safe, nobody has broken the windows or broken the doors and gone in. I have 6-inch cement walls. Maybe in the US they don't even make cement walls, wooden walls will do. Now, any criminal trying to break those wooden walls will take about 45 minutes to 1 hour, makes a lot of noise. Very high chance a neighbor will find, or somebody will find, and will get detected, even if I'm Starbucks for 1 hour. And there are 7 million houses like this, all fine. Now, one fine day, some gang of Russian thieves come in, and they have a technology to break this wall in 2 minutes. You go for Starbucks, 2 minutes, your house is broken in, you're burgled. What does the police say? You have the wrong standards. You know, you're using SHA-1, which is 64-bit. The latest standard is SHA-3, which is 256-bit. Change your walls from 6-inch to 12-inch. Now, 7 million houses, and go sue your architect for not giving an upgradable house. You should be upgradable. So now, 7 million houses have to order cement, meat, and over the next 1 month in a ziffy go, you will have a logjam. The San Francisco lorries will be... That is the way we think about IoT security. It's not an upgradable device. Houses are not upgradable by design. Why should the cost of protecting against criminal behavior be passed to house owners? It is the state's job. I can expound more on it, but there's an IEEE standard we are proposing. It's a community-based standard because there's a lot of investment money in cybersecurity. No company will sponsor our approach to life. We are proposing a different way of thinking about configuring. PKI at scale doesn't work. There's a completely different architecture, disruptive way, which will make it easier.
Sorry, I'll have to interject because running out of time. I want to hear from Bosch in terms of how they are taking end-to-end IoT approach and why are they investing a lot in building that ecosystem.
Okay, I was hoping you won't ask me that question. Yeah, I mean, as I told in the beginning, IoT is not outside the core business of Bosch anymore. So when I talk about enabling every electronic product coming out of Bosch, my responsibility doesn't end by just enabling that to be used over an IoT system. As a customer, I'm not talking as Bosch, but as a customer, I would rather have a Bosch app which helps me run my dishwashers and washing machine, which is much more secure, and which helps me to actually manage and securely run my home. Of course, we won't upgrade the house, but we will move from a hut to probably an apartment or a better house. So, I mean, like we have been upgrading Windows 3.1 to Windows 5, whatever. I mean, now we are at Windows 10. So we keep doing that, and we have the responsibility to do that as individuals. Now, coming back to a very important topic that you mentioned, which I did not elaborate in the beginning, was how do you deal with all these different partners, 30 different
right.
partners? And this is where IoT solutions are different from typical IT solutions, because technology is not even half of the problem that you are solving here. There is much more than that. You have each of these partners who have their own objectives of their organizations and their own value systems with security. It's very important to find the right one when you're designing your IoT systems. Just as an example, if one of these partners goes out of business, what do? You change it with another one, or let's say you are no longer happy with a vendor, you terminate the contract, but he's still running your sensors. So what
Absolutely.
Do you do with that?
Very
so
important.
These are the things which are not necessarily technical. These are important aspects that you need to look at.
Absolutely. So Arvind, you've been dealing with, 600 startups in yeah. India on IoT?
Yeah.
To his point, half of them may not exist going forward. How should companies think about it?
I think consumers are quite aware that it's a phase of experimentation. Quite
okay.
often, they don't even know what they want. So I don't think this is a very large question at this end, as Raman has been
saying no.
Experiment.
Yeah, experiment. Okay. So concluding remarks from you before which we open to the audience. And okay. how should they be thinking about it?
In my mind, actually, I look at it as three steps. The first one, go ahead and identify a use case which will allow you to wet your feet. There are enough and more value expounding use cases that you will find the moment you look around on others without getting into too much of risk related to security. So you experiment on this one. This is a standard. I have been a consultant all my life, and actually this is a standard thing, which is more in terms of don't boil the ocean, boil actually a smaller cup of water if you want to actually go ahead and drink tea. The second is don't get worried. Enough and more people who will make you worried. Please don't get worried. Like I said, actually, I wouldn't be here if I had been thinking about those 1.3 million deaths that happen every day. And every minute actually something is happening, I will not actually be here on this. I will be safe inside my house. So that will not help. So don't be worried. Go ahead and actually look at it on experimenting. And last, when you are taking those experiments, be careful. Just to give you the same safety example, when I used to be a kid, I used to actually go ahead and play in the streets. It was normal at that point in time. But today, do I allow my son to go ahead and play in front of my street? I don't. So be careful, but go ahead and actually experiment.
Not worried, but be careful. Concluding remarks on IoT?
No, that one I completely agree with. I think treat IoT security, whether you're a product company or an enterprise, with the same measure of seriousness, risk assessment, threat modeling as your regular software development. And we are, as an industry, a technology industry, we are still grappling with how to build secure systems. So going down further and reducing that level of alertness in designing IoT solutions is not the prudent thing to do. So I completely agree that it's something that is adding value to your business. Do try it, but treat it the same as doing any other software or hardware project.
So next 5 years, positive on IoT?
Oh, very much.
Positive on IoT?
Yes.
Entire life
I think.
Is
he better be. He better be positive on IoT.
When we started the IoT forum, we never imagined we will have 620 IoT startups, and about 100 of them are cash positive, and
nice.
We will probably end the year with 1,000. So it's very, very
All positive. Right, we have run out of time, but we will still allow one or two questions. If anyone has any questions that you would want the panelists to answer, we have one here. Can we have the mic here?
Dinesh from Itachi. So the question here is this. We have this IoT platforms like Predix. We also have a platform, Lumada. They have a platform.
Everyone has these days.
Yeah. Is this not the responsibility to take care of the security?
No questions. No questions. In fact, actually, Hitachi High Technologies is my partner in Japan. Hitachi goes ahead and actually sells Cerebra to their end customers. You can't actually introduce a security risk when somebody, $80 billion company like actually Hitachi is going ahead and selling this. 3 days back, why I said was actually I wanted to leave the message saying that don't be scared. 3 days back, my platform was tested. And after badgering it with actually 2,500 security tests, not even actually three tests, that too actually the lowest level of risk was what was identified. So you have to be careful. It's not about actually not being careful in terms of this. But if you start talking security, which is what typically a lot of IT guys actually do, before you start thinking about actually the millions and millions of dollars that you can benefit from, then it won't happen. So if I keep, for example, I talked about actually the Uber incident in 2014. Today, are people actually stopping to take Uber? The value always trumps the risks that are involved. So be focused on the half glass filled, half glass empty. Be focused on the half glass filled.
Thank you. Great. Any other questions? We'll allow one more if someone has a question. Great. Looks like everyone is done for the day. All right. Great. I think we've had an interesting conversation. We had some contrarian viewpoints, but that's the fun of these panels. I think we hopefully had a few takeaways, and thank you so much, all of you, for providing and being genuine about what's the reality of how the market is evolving. The speakers, I'm assuming, will be available. So if you have more questions and if you are too shy to ask them here, they'll be around. You can catch them for coffee and have some more fun. Thank you so much.
Thank you, panel members.